What's the hybrid answer? Because I think a lot of people feel one thing about being in the office, which is quite positive, being with their friends, being with their colleagues, and another thing about commuting.
Yes, that's right. People like the idea that they don't have to spend hours on trains and buses or what have you, or cars even, to get into the office, and they save that time. Colleen, are you at home? Do you work at home?
I do. I've been working at home.
Ambassadors will hold talks today on whether to allow unrestricted visits from British tourists who are fully vaccinated. They're expected to lift the current ban on non-essential travel from the UK, despite Boris Johnson keeping most of Europe off the mask. And Amazon has permanently blocked the use of its facial recognition technology on law enforcement agencies to protect driving motorists suspension from last year. Get sport now with Phil Sells.
Chelsea took a big step towards Champions League qualification with a 2-1 win over Leicester City in front of 8,000 supporters at Stamford Bridge. Chelsea came from 2 goals down to beat the league camp and won the Champions Manchester City 3-2. It's United scored late goals through Patrick Bamford and Tyler Roberts to win Southampton 2-0 in secondaries. Manchester United were out to a 1-1 draw by already relegated Fulham at Old Trafford. Blackpool beat Oxford 3-0 in the first leg of their League One playoff semi-final, while Newport County were 2-0 winners over Forest Green Rovers in the League Two playoff semi-final. Rugby Union and the Exeter Chiefs number 8, Sam Simmons, has broken the Premiership try-scoring record for a season. British and Irish Lions forward passed the previous record held by Christy Wade and Dominic Chapman. His hat-trick appears to have been Irish to 19 tries for the season. The signal for this winter's Ashes Tour of Australia has been released. It will begin on the 8th of December in Brisbane, and for the first time since 1994-95, the final test will be held at the Wacker in Perth.
Welcome back. The UK's tech sector is 10 times bigger than it was 10 years ago, according to government figures. That's based on the number of unicorns we get in children's books at school. It's a tech company valued at more than $1 billion. A decade ago, there were 8, while by the end of 2020, there were 81. Quite the rise, and annual investment has grown from £1 billion to £11 billion. But in recent weeks, we've been hearing about skills shortages in the industry. Last week, we spoke to Apprentice winner Mark Wright, who's struggling to hire people for his digital marketing company, Kind Online.
Right now, I have 14 roles immediately available. Over the last month, we've had one application. It's very, very worrying because of the nature of our industry. It's new skills, Facebook advertising, Google advertising. You know, some of this stuff's only been around 5 to 10 years. There's a huge skill shortage of people who can actually do the job. We've got huge numbers.
Digital Minister Matt Warley. It's all working to make up to money. Unless businesses like Mark Rydell, as you just heard, can get the people they need, how's the technology industry going to continue to grow?
Well, that's absolutely right. What we need to do now to secure that growth is a range of things. Some of it is around continuing political infrastructure, some of it is around things like the skills review, but the business is growing in the UK, but a huge chunk of it, the biggest chunk of it, is around making sure that there are skills. That starts in schools, of course it does, but it carries on right through the whole of someone's work and life, and that's why you see from government a range of measures, whether it's local digital skills partnerships, whether it's the Kickstart scheme, whether it's apprentices, whether it's the lifelong learning guarantee, a range of interventions to try and make sure we can make the most of the opportunities that we've built over the last 10 years.
So there's a lot there at grassroots level, yes, schools, but you know, traditionally younger people are pretty good with technology, they're wizards, but what about older workers that have possibly lost their jobs during the pandemic? Do they have the right skills? And what are you doing about training them?
So I think yes and no is the answer. We shouldn't ignore the fact that very often a teenager who is very savvy at helping older relatives fix their kit is not necessarily someone who's completely equipped with all the skills that businesses such as the one that you just heard from need.
No, but they probably have been in a better position to perhaps learn those skills, you know, considering that they're learning that at a young age.
Foundation. And I'm not pretending the opposite for a moment, but you are right that lifelong learning challenge that has been around for years and years is exactly why we're spending a new £95 million on that lifetime skills guarantee that I mentioned, that means that people, however old they are, can develop new skills, develop new, get better jobs. That's really important, but it's only one part of a package where very often it is businesses themselves that are retraining their workforces, because investing in the future is in their interest as much as it is in the broader national interest as well.
So we've seen lots of technology companies evolve, grow in the last 10 years. I was talking about the stats a bit earlier on. But they all tend to be in the London, all the sort of future unicorns are based in the capital. How do you spread that about?
So there are really good examples outside London, of course there are, but you're right. That levelling up agenda that you hear so much from the government about is crucially important. And foundationally, there is making sure that there is the infrastructure there. That gigabit broadband upgrade is what a lot of this rests upon. But it's no good just giving people a connection and walking away. Of course, it's not. What we've got to do on top of that is, as I say, things like those local digital skills partnerships. If you look at places like Stoke, but definitely not in London, a burgeoning video games industry, a burgeoning Silicon Stoke scene in places like that, and you can see other examples as well. But levelling up digitally is the key challenge that follows from spending that £5 million on infrastructure.
Sue, I want to bring you back in here, Sue Luneman. You work in the industry. Is there enough support, do you think, for digital skills and older workers?
Well, I think the thing is that more support is always welcome, right? So that's the first thing. But secondly, you know, I'm worried about the job application that Mark has made the issue with them.
In terms of resources, and that is where the challenge is. So in essence, what you do find is that a lot of Africans now are starting to realize that the government are not carrying the best interest of the countries. And this is what you see in Kenya, where we have got a movement that is actually saying that they do not want the IMF money. It's not that they don't need the IMF money, it's the fact that they think that the money is going to be misappropriated when it comes into the country. And they need to have a governance structure that is going to ensure that there's accountability for these resources.
Trevor, it's good to talk to you. Thank you so much for joining us on Newsday. Trevor Hambayi, Senior Managing Partner at Development Finance Associates.
Each day on the BBC World Service, conservation efforts to restore and rewild Galapagos Islands have been boosted by a pledge of $43 million from, among others, actor Leonardo DiCaprio. The Galapagos is extraordinary because it's been isolated for so long, wildlife never developed a fear of humans, and many of the species found there are very rare. The conservationist Paula Castaño in Santa Cruz Island in the Galapagos first described to me the area around.
The Galapagos is very special because here communities coexist very closely with nature, and so it's very easy for us. If you look out your window, you can see nature around you. You don't have to go very far away, like driving hours or even just walking a mile, to be able to see wildlife. For example, you can see marine iguanas, sea lions basking under the sun, and they are very unique in a way that they came very close to you. They are not afraid to humans. Be honest, like they don't care about us. They are more interested in seeing, oh, and checking you out, like, oh, you are kind of interesting human. But that's why it's very unique of these species. Not only that they have evolved separately and they're very unique and can only found here, but it's the way that they behave.
This incredible environment you work in, are many of the species threatened?
There are hundreds of them, like around 250 species are threatened. Like, for example, on Floriana, which is the island that I work the most, there is 54 species that are threatened, and unfortunately, there is 13 species of those that have been gone from the island. We are lucky enough that they remain in some islets surrounding the island, and they can be rewild back into the island, and so that's where we are looking forward with this campaign, to be able to reestablish these populations.
How do you actually do that if you've got, let's say, a mockingbird or an iguana? How do you make sure it thrives in a new environment?
There is a lot of different things that play in here. We will look to make sure that the ecosystem where they are, you don't have the threats that in the first place driven to extinction or locally extinct. So that's one of the key aspects. And you have to restore the island to be able to remove that threat so they can be translocated back into that island. But there is a lot of different work. It depends on what kind of species are you working on. For example, Toriana mockingbirds, we will potentially bring them from Champion or Gardner and place them back on the island. We could potentially just release them, or even they can come by themselves. But for pink iguanas, there will be a different activities that will have to happen. For example, like establish a captive population, as they currently live in an active volcano, and they can just suddenly disappear. So they will need
to speak out publicly. Cheyenne, who was set.
Few days' time about it. It's also been warning people not to go on holiday to places like France and Greece that are currently on the travel amber list. They saw thousands have already jetted off.
Bear in mind you're going to have to pay for testing, but you're also going to have to self-isolate for 10 days at home, not going out, and if you fail to obey that, then you will face fines of up to £10,000.
That's in an LBC News exclusive. We have found that 110 direct flights from India have landed in the UK since it was placed on the Do Not Travel red list on the 23rd of April. The countries on the red list are banned from flying here. LBC's Westminster correspondent Ben Kentish has more.
When India was added to the red list on the 23rd of April, most people assumed that that meant a ban on direct flights. It's a reasonable assumption because that's exactly what happened when there was other countries were placed on the red list, South Africa, Brazil, nine others. Flights are still banned to the UK from those countries. Not with India. The UK government decided not to put India on the red list. And we've done some analysis that shows, as you say, that since the 23rd of April alone, 110 direct flights from India have landed in the UK. Now, it's a little bit tricky to say exactly how many passengers were on, by the way, it's 4.5 flights a day on average. But what we do know is in the 2 weeks after India was added to the red list, more than 4,200 or so passengers arriving from India were tested as part of the test and trace system. That's more than any other country in the world, many times over, with the exception of Pakistan. If that trend continued for the last 2 weeks, no reason to think it wouldn't. It would suggest about 8,500 passengers from India had arrived in the UK while the country was on the red list. But we Transport spokesman told me we have adopted and bolstered our world-leading testing quarantine systems for incoming passengers since the start of the pandemic. This is interesting, and we'll continue to closely monitor direct flights from a small number of friendly countries to see if a blanket ban would be necessary and proportionate. They say public safety always comes first, but they need to also consider other factors, such as, they say, critical freight and helping British nationals return home safely. Now, it's worth saying, on the freight point, these are all passenger flights, they're not cargo flights, and on the helping British nationals return home point, well, that may be so. If you're a British national in Brazil, South Africa, or one of those other 11 countries, you still cannot fly home directly. If you're in India, Pakistan, or Bangladesh, you can. Now, I spoke to Labour's Shadow Home Secretary, Nick Thomas Simmons, who told me this was an utter mess.
The UK government has created chaos. The mess over the banned flights and the red list is yet more evidence of the utter mess the Conservatives have made protecting our borders against COVID, whilst scenes of people from red list countries having to mix at airports is deeply worrying. Labour warned time and time again that a comprehensive hotel quarantine system was needed to help prevent dangerous variants reaching the UK. The UK government mistakes have risked letting variants in, putting our hope for freedoms at risk.
Obviously, it almost goes without saying that it is the Indian variant, so-called B16172, that is of most concern now to the British government and scientists. On the day, in fact, last week, Boris Johnson used a press conference to warn the public that that very variant could derail plans to end social distancing on the 21st of June. 7 flights on that day alone, directly from India, landed in the UK. So questions for the government about whether they will look again at a flight ban. The answer, for now at least, appears to be no.
LBC's Westminster correspondent Ben Kentish with that exclusive analysis there. Well, another 7 people in the UK have died of coronavirus. 2,412 new cases also been confirmed in the past 24 hours. Infections in Bolton have now climbed to the highest level since January, equivalent to 302 cases per 100,000 people. The situation in the northwest of England, LBC's reporter Sarah Collins.
Well, once again, long queues have been forming in Bolton and Blackburn as people continue to try and get vaccinated. Extra doses are being handed out in both areas to tackle those high infection rates that keep on rising. Now, people over the age of 18 who have underlying health conditions, live with elderly, vulnerable people, or the carers, are eligible for vaccines. And they seem to be taking up that offer. These people I spoke to in Blackburn earlier told me why they were there.
We're in regular contact with all the people on the front line, quite old as well, so just to be safe, just to get the vaccine done.
You feel safe? No. Some people might be a bit scared of getting the jab because they don't think it's going to happen, but the seat in there being lovely, you feel safe.
There's been a lot of talk about vaccine hesitancy in both areas over the past few days. It's after the Health Secretary had said that the majority of people admitted to hospital in Bolton had been eligible for a jab but not taken it up. Now, in response to that, new COVID vaccine pop-up clinics have opened up in Blackburn. There's a few more coming online later on in the week as well to try and get hold of the Indian strain. Now, Jane Scattergood is the lead for vaccinations in Lancashire and South Cumbria, and she says they're doing all they can to try and bring infection rates down.
We've secured 16,000 extra doses for Blackburn and surrounding areas, and we've set up a number of hyper-local, super-convenient clinics for people to hop into.
Well, the backdrop, of course, is the date of June the 21st, and whether that will be delayed, and again, there is that possibility of local lockdowns. Now, Bolton and Blackburn faced really tough restrictions all last summer too, as they struggled then to try and get hold of infection rates. Now, for hospitality businesses, it's especially frustrating. Richard Hibbert runs 2 restaurants, one in Bolton and one in Lancashire, and he says local lockdowns just don't make any sense.
All the advice was you could get on a train for 20 minutes and travel to the centre of Manchester, you could go to Wigan, you could go to Chorley, you just couldn't meet anybody else if you were from Bolton. So there's such huge gaps in lockdown.
sense of what the production team was saying here was when Mary went missing in 1968, she was wearing a blue coat, a blue and white dress, and a blue bag.
What's your place at DCI John Turner there? Well, I'm Rachel Gerrish. This is LBC News. Coming up, fans return to the football stands. We'll get more on sport in just a moment.
This is LBC News. This week's best offers at Waitrose. Just one great value offer after another. Who needs fireworks going off when you have that, eh?
Save 25% on Pin 70cl bottles. Selected Hellmann's Squeezy Mayonnaise for 30ml was £2.50, now £1.50. And Cornetto 6 packs, now just £4.50.
This week's best offers at Waitrose.
I said there was no need for fireworks.
Selected lines in stores subject to availability. Prices may vary in Little Waitrose, Channel Island and concessions.
Hey, Harry. Hello, mate. Any tips for the big game?
It's a tough one to call. Your best bet is to ask Michael Owen. Here, Michael.
Hello, Gaffer.
You got any tips for the football?
Oh, I think we've got plenty of goals.
No, I can't see that. Both defences are strong.
Yeah, but the little fella up top's lightning.
Sorry, lads. I've got to go. I've got money on the next race.
Whether you listen to Harry or Michael, make your best bet at Betfair. Search online for latest offers. 18 plus, be careful, but please get responsible.
Manchester City, 3-2 on the south coast. Nearly 8,000 fans were there to see it. Supporters were allowed back to matches for the first time this year. This is Emma Corr, reports from the Amex Stadium.
This is the first time this many fans have been allowed back on site here in 15 months. The end of February last year was when large crowds of Seagull supporters were in this stadium. So obviously many delighted to be back and be part of a crowd again.
Just really exciting to be there and see the players again and just something the atmosphere. And it was good. I enjoyed it very much.
We felt very safe. It was all really good fun. And it would be great to get some more fans back in there.
Amazing experience, great atmosphere.
To half full if all goes to plan, but it's fans returning to Premier League matches like this one which will help determine that and plan out how one day we could see stadiums completely full again.
Emma Corr reporting from the Amex there on that 3-2 win for Brighton over Man City. Elsewhere, Chelsea beat Leicester 2-1, right between the two teams hoping for Champions League qualification. Manchester United were held to a 1-1 draw by Fulham, and won 2-0 at Southampton. In League One, Blackpool have taken a huge step towards the playoff final. They beat Oxford 3-0 in the away leg of their semi-final. And in League Two, Newport have won their semi-final first leg over Forest Green 2-0. In Rugby Union, Exeter have moved up to second in the Premiership with a 31-12 bonus point victory at London Irish. The champions ran 5 tries, Sam Simmons got 3 of them.
Where the news never stops, LBC News.
In the city, then.
of London, Sadiq Khan, says the plans are in place already to keep case rates low.
With this virus, there will be new variants. We've had the Kent variant, the South African variant. We've got processes in place to address that, from surge testing to regular testing to contact tracing.
The Prime Minister is set to face pressure on confusing international travel rules in the House of Commons later. Facing Labour leader Sir Keir Starmer for the first time since the local elections, Boris Johnson is likely to face questions on where it's safe to holiday after one of his ministers said all international trips were dangerous yesterday. The New York Attorney General's office says it's now conducting a criminal investigation into Donald Trump's business empire after expanding what had previously been a civil probe. Investigators are working with the Manhattan District Attorney's Office, which has already been conducting a criminal investigation into the former U.S. President and his company for 2 years. No explanation was given as to what prompted the change today. An Oxford professor is criticising the idea of vaccinating children whilst poorer countries don't have enough jabs for adults. It comes as it emerged the UK had enough vaccines to offer the Pfizer jab to children aged over 12 if it's clinically approved. Professor Andrew Pollard, who helped develop the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, says global vaccine inequity is plain to see.
It feels completely wrong to be in a situation, morally, first of all, where we're allowing that to happen. But whilst in many countries vaccines are being rolled out to younger and younger populations, at very, very low risk.
And one of the Queen's two new puppies given to her while the Duke of Edinburgh was in hospital has reportedly died. Fergus, a young Dorgie pup, was one of the pair given to the Queen after Philip fell ill. Was given as to what prompted the change today. An Oxford professor is criticising the idea of vaccinating children whilst poorer countries don't have enough jabs for adults. It comes as it emerged the UK had enough vaccines to offer the Pfizer jab to children aged over 12 if it's clinically approved. Professor Andrew Pollard, who helped develop the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, says global vaccine inequity is plain to see.
It feels completely wrong to be in a situation morally, first of all, where we're allowing that to happen. But whilst in many countries, vaccines are being rolled out to younger and younger populations, it's very, very important.
One of the Queen's two new puppies given to her while the Duke of Edinburgh was in hospital has reportedly died. Fergus and the Dorking Corp was
killed. Sport.
Fans returned to Premier League games for the first time in over a year last night. Manchester United were held to a 1-1 draw at Old Trafford by Fulham. Pre-match protest by fans outside failed to materialise. Meanwhile, Leeds United guaranteed themselves a top half finish following their 2-0 win over Southampton at St Mary's. Also on the south coast, Brighton stunned Premier League champions Manchester City as they came from behind to win 3-2. The Seagulls were brought on by their 8,000 home supporters. And it was a rematch of the FA Cup final, with Chelsea welcoming Leicester City to Stamford Bridge. But Leicester's luck couldn't strike twice in a week, with the game finishing up in a 2-1 victory for the Blues. The result means Chelsea overtake Leicester in the table. And bosses of both Man City and Man United remained tight-lipped last night when asked about the possibility of signing Harry Kane. The England captains believed to be looking for a move from Spurs.
News Radio UK. For the latest news in Cardiff, listen on your smart speaker.
The New York Attorney General's office says it's now conducting a criminal investigation into Donald Trump's business empire. It's expanding what had previously been a civil probe. No explanation was given as to what prompted the change in its approach or why it chose to announce it publicly. A rocket launched from Gaza has killed two Thai workers in southern Israel hours after Israeli airstrikes toppled a six-story building in the Palestinian territory that has across the region have gone on a general strike in rare collective action against Israel's policies. The United Arab Emirates has announced it will begin offering booster shots to those who received the Chinese state-backed Sinopharm vaccine 6 months after vaccination. The brief statement comes after some in the UAE received a third shot amid concerns of a low antibody response from the vaccine. Last month, China's top disease control official, in a rare acknowledgement, admitted that current vaccines offer low protection against coronavirus. No one knows what COP stands for. That's the message from Arnold Schwarzenegger to Government Minister Alok Sharma ahead of the climate conference in Scotland later this year. The two were in conversation as part of a monthly web series in which Mr. Schwarzenegger speaks to various environmental leaders.
I mean, think about it. I mean, when you say COP26, I was just wanting to know from you what that feels like, because, I mean, it's like COP. No one knows what the COP stands for.
We're going to have this event in Glasgow, as you know, in November. And I very much hope by the end of this year, everyone does know what this is, because, you know, this is about tackling climate change.
And singer Jason Derulo has welcomed his first child with influencer girlfriend Jenna Frumes. She gave birth to a boy on the 8th of May. They've named him Jason King Derulo.
Showbiz.
Naomi Campbell's become a mother to a baby girl. She announced the news on Instagram as she shared a photo of her hand holding a baby's foot. The designer Marc Jacobs and the British Vogue editor Edward Ennifle were among those congratulating her. Leonardo DiCaprio has announced a commitment of over £30 million to rewild the Galapagos Islands. The initiative is in partnership with Rewild, a conservation charity that DiCaprio is part of. We'll see efforts put in to help endangered animals in the Galapagos and also protect the island's wildlife. Circus performers who've spent lockdown trying to practice their acts at home are now preparing to wow audiences once again. Blackpool Tower Circus is preparing to reopen on Saturday after the pandemic caused the longest closure history. And new images created by David Hockney using an iPad are to go on display at the World Academy. The digital paintings were created by the artist last year and depicted the arrival of spring in Normandy. A total of 116 images will be on show from Sunday at the London Gallery.
Business.
Tenant demand in London's private rental sector is falling overall, while significant increases are being seen elsewhere across England and Wales. That's according to a new survey. More than half of landlords with properties in central London saw tenant demand fall in the first quarter of the year compared to the same period last. That's according to a poll of the National Residential Landlords Association. Overall, across England and Wales, 31% of landlords reported tenant demand for properties had increased. The number of tech unicorns in the UK saw tenfold in the last decade, and startups are bringing more funding for growth than any other European country, according to new figures. In 2010, there were just 8 tech unicorns, that's companies worth more than $1 billion. By 2020, this had gone up to 81. And 3 classes of travel are being offered on Britain's domestic railway for the first time in decades. A premium economy option has been launched by Avanti West Coast, giving passengers on the West Coast main line wider seats, more legroom, and a guaranteed table.
Has your business lost at least £40,000 as a result of COVID restrictions? Do you have business interruption insurance? If the answer is yes, COVID claims could help you reclaim financial losses. Even if your initial claim was refused, you've been made a low offer, or you just don't know where to start. All on a no-win, no-fee basis. Just text LOST to 66777 for help from COVID claims. Regulated by the FCA. Text LOST to 66777.
News Radio UK.
A mix of sunshine and showers for most today. They'll get heavier in the east with a chance of some thunder. Turning fine in the west, highs of 17 degrees. Says the plans are in place already to keep case rates low.
With this virus, there will be new variants. We've had the Kent variant, the South African variant, And we've got processes in place to address that, from surge testing to regular testing to contact tracing.
The Prime Minister is set to face pressure on confusing international travel rules in the House of Commons later. A criminal investigation into Donald Trump's business empire after expanding what had previously been a civil probe. Investigators are working with the Manhattan District Attorney's Office, which has already been conducting a criminal investigation into the former US president and his company for 2 years. No explanation was given as to what prompted the change today. An Oxford professor is criticising the idea of vaccinating children whilst poorer countries don't have enough jabs for adults. It comes as it emerged the UK had enough vaccines to offer the Pfizer jab to children aged over 12 if it's clinically approved. Professor Andrew Pollard, who helped develop the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, says global vaccine inequity is plain to see.
It feels completely wrong to be in a situation morally, first of all, where we were allowed to whilst in many countries vaccines have been rolled out to younger populations for very, very many years.
One of the Queen's two new puppies given to her while the Duke of Edinburgh was in hospital has reportedly died. Fergus, a young Dorky pup, was one of the care kittens after Philip fell ill.
There are strict rules about the adverts next to the blood. And there are also very strict rules about broadcast and broadcasting. And say, for example, every time I mention the Royal Albert Hall, I mention that I'm a trustee, because people need to know, and there needs to be clarity with interest so that people recognise where there isn't. Whereas with influencers, there's all sorts of stuff been going on, free flights, this, then that, oh, just mention us, and the rules are not the same.
No, they're not. I think you do have to declare. I mean, it's slightly grey territory as well when you have to declare what you've been given versus what you haven't. But I think going back to the story, we can make up our mind and say, oh, we should be allowed to go if we've been vaccinated. But at the end of the day, we're kind of at the hands of the other country that we hope will receive us, right?
So, well, they all want our money. So, okay, so if you were in my position, so I totally understand what Amber means, and Amber says don't go on holiday. So if I had the choice, I would say, you know what, I'll put it off for another year. But I'm dealing with a couple of companies who are saying, yeah, but you're allowed to come here, so we're not going to give you your money back, and no, you can't delay it. So if that's the case, should I go if I'm going to lose quite a considerable amount of money?
Well, this is the thing, and actually the tragedy with the whole pandemic, well, there's obviously many tragedies, but I think one of the biggest ones is it seems to be the poorer families that hit the hardest for a plethora of reasons, right? And this is just, you know, you actually can go on holiday, as you've said. We'll have, I've put probably money that they've been saving for a long time into this, and they are going to be the ones that will suffer the most if they end up losing that money. I have to say, though, say at the same time as that, we live in a beautiful country, James, and I'm a massive fan of the Lake District. I grew up in Dorset, which I love, and I appreciate there's not that many places left to sort of look out for a weekend or something. But if it was, you know, solely down to me, I would be staying in the UK this summer. We had glorious weather last year. What's to say that we're not going to have it again this year? So stay in the UK this summer, guys. I would advise that.
Have you looked at it?
Did
you see what was happening yesterday? I am also a big fan, as you know, and those who listen to me will know that I'm a big fan of the British Isles. I think we've got some incredible places. I love to champion not only the fantastic natural environment that we have, but also the incredible produce as well. All sorts of stuff that we have, which is sensational. That having been said, it's when, you know, if companies and government made it easy for me to do the right thing, I'm very happy to do the right thing. But what I'm not prepared to do is, having done the right thing last year and put things off, and then having quite a lot of money that, you know, it doesn't matter how much money you have, and yeah, I guess it could go and I wouldn't lose my life. Having said that, if I've had both vaccines, goes under the headline of Dogs for the Office. 1 in 5 workers will return to the office only if they can bring their dogs, according to a survey. An estimated 3.2 million households have bought pets during the pandemic, and new owners say that they're facing hefty bills for dog minders if they can't continue working from home. Good point, well made. However, how about this, though? Under the headline, Two Jacks Beware, I get locked down, but I get up again. Chumbawamba are back. I know. Look at this. You can be a one-hit wonder and you can come back. Chumbawamba, they've got it up again. 24 years after Tug Thumping, I get knocked down. The anarcho-pop outfit was formed in 1982 and split in 2012. They will be featured in a post-punk film. And their 1997 smack, which I'm assuming you're about to watch. How old were you in 1997?
Oh, four.
Anyway, I remember that. I was a fully fledged adult working. Anyway, that anyway, there's number two smash it, which gets played on TV and stuff and everything. The lead singer is now 60. Anyway, they featured the documentary now about Chumbawamba, and it's taken 5 years to make. I'm assuming that you can make a whole career if you have a one-hit wonder. In those old days, you could make enough money at the time.
I'd imagine so, yeah. I mean, those were the days of selling millions and millions of singles and albums, and I imagine that also back then, because we didn't have any streaming services or YouTube or whatever, someone would hear one song, think the whole album's great, and then even if it isn't, the artist still gets the tenor or whatever it would have been back then for the vinyl. So, yeah, a lot more money in physical sales back then.
It certainly was. James, we'll talk a little bit about what you and the band are up to, and also some more stories. Yeah.
Online, on DAB Plus, and on the Talk Radio app.
I think we have to be very alert to the various concerns.
Talk Radio.
Sometimes running a trade or construction business can feel like working out in a sauna filled with wasps. But Xero accounting software can help. You can quote an invoice on the go to get paid faster. Soon it'll feel less like working out and more like chilling out. Search Xero with an X, because healthy business is beautiful.
So I saw Nervy Nigel playing golf, and I said, why so chilled? And he said,
my car's in for a service.
And I said, I thought you'd be hysterical. And he said,
no, I bought my car away from Cinch. You got Cinch Care.
Cinch Care, servicing, lifetime warranty and breakdown assistance for under £35 a month. Total peace of mind for not a lot of. And he said,
Wedge.
Exactly, Nigel.
No, pass me Wedge.
It's apparently some type of golf bat. You're in the driving seat now, Britain. Cinch, cars without the faff. T's and C's and exclusions apply. Price based on 12,000 miles per year.
I am the identity thief. I make a fortune by pretending to be people like you. And I like to keep it that way. That's why I don't want you to sign up to me.
Which scam alerts? Our free service that keeps you up to date with the latest scams. No wonder scammers don't want you to sign up. Visit witch.co.uk/scamalerts.
When was the last time you were asked to fail? Never, I bet. But here I am, spending my weekend trying to swim. Well, we're in 4K. I'm not doing too well. Trained to be a reserve soldier. The failure isn't something to be avoided. It's something I pay to do. Because you learn to win when it really matters. Fail, learn, win. Find where you belong, search on your reserve.
In hospital in France with COVID, it's still a big problem. Why is now the right time to open up?
Hey, look,
apply a public policy, especially in health, you need to have acceptance of the population, and people are really needing an opening, and they need to have a perspective of what will be the situation at the end of June. And as you mentioned before, we are today on step two, the progressive reopening. And this day, I have to say, is really awaited by the Parisian and by French people. They know that the reopening has to be progressive, but it's the only way to still have a life and to still have a community open, and of course by progressively maintaining some restrictions, but not all restrictions.
Listening to you, it sounds like the politicians have listened to the demands of the people, that psychological need to open up, and that's understandable, but leadership is about taking tough decisions sometimes, isn't it? It's about saying, well, maybe the country's not quite ready, I'm sorry, but we need to hold on a bit.
Well, you're right, politicians have to make tough decisions, and these tough decisions were made in the past, but anyway, life is not compatible with a complete lockdown, and some shops were open anyway, and some activities were still taking place. So we have to reopen progressively, and the interest of progressive policy is that in case the figures are bad, we will come back to the proper situation. But we need to live with this virus, and vaccination is a mass vaccination now, so it can give some perspectives to open some shops and to open some museums and some terraces, but we are still not living in a country where everything is open.
Sure, 20 million, I think, or 67 million or so, received their first jab. What about the criticism made by many in the opposition that the lockdown was delayed too long? People died because Monsieur Macron simply didn't order, take that tough decision to lock down quick enough. How would you respond to that?
Opposition has to oppose itself to exist. I think that there is a consensus in the country that the measures that were taken were the good ones. And again, public policy and government and every actor of the health system in France was dedicated to cope with the situation. And the start of the vaccination was slow and was progressive. But now we don't face any real opposition to the vaccine. And we have systems of vaccination that are open in the main cities. The doctors, the vaccine, old people, and the establishment for old people. Mass vaccination was done for the people of 75 years old. So really, of course, the situation is not perfect, and there is no certainty. The situation is not so bad.
All right, thanks very much indeed for talking to Neville Pepper about the position with on March 1.
Newsday BBC World Service. So if you're in a territory that's opening up again, are you thinking about your first trip back to the cinema? Well, Zack Snyder has directed some of the most ambitious blockbusters of this millennium. 300, Man of Steel, Batman vs Superman. But at a time when cinemas are looking for exactly this kind of film to entice people back in, Zack Snyder is releasing his latest, Army of the Dead, on Netflix. Our entertainment correspondent Colin Patterson spoke to the movie maker who was in a film studio in LA.
Producer Zack Snyder's DC superhero movies have taken almost £4 billion at the worldwide box office.
Isn't that right? Batman.
They're the print fair which gets moviegoers to the multiplex.
There's $200 million in the law to release this
film. That control means so much to Zack Snyder. In 2017, he walked away from the big budget Justice League film. He felt undermined when Warner Brothers hired the director Joss Whedon to work alongside him. He lost the appetite to fight the studio when his daughter Autumn took her own life. But in March this year, he was able to release his own four-hour Snyder Cut.
Political film, is it? Because there are refugee camps, there is a wall being built.
Zombie movies are at their best when they're engaging in such a primary real zombie movie holding a mirror up. It's a monster movie where the monster is us. It's us without our humanity. What can we do?
As for cinemas, he does think they still have a future.
How ready will cinema goers be?
You know, it's hard to say. I know here in the States,
year's Oscars, watched by fewer than 10 million. What needs to be done to make them popular, bring them back as a cultural event?
It's on us a little bit, the movie directors and the filmmakers. These were great movies, but I think
this is the BBC World Service with the story of the 1961 mission to send the first person into space.
Hundreds of kilometers above the Earth, Yuri Gagarin is witness to a spectacle that no human in history before him ever experienced.
Yuri Gagarin was embraced by the leader of the communist world as the hero of a communist victory.
In doing so, he became an instrument of a new conflict, the Cold War. Ideological battle between the superpowers.
To beat the Americans, huge shortcuts were taken.
At one point,
they weren't even going to design a spacesuit, because in that time,
the Soviet space program would deliver blow after shaming blow on the Americans.
I guess the American people are warned that a foreign country, especially an enemy country, can do this. We fear this.
Gagarin and the Lost Moon. Saturday at 11 GMT.
Hello, welcome. You're listening to Newsday from the BBC World Service. Thanks for joining us. Claire McDonnell and James Copnell with you.
This half hour, more on how Israel's neighbours see the conflict with the Palestinians. Yesterday we heard from Lebanon, today we go to Jordan.
As India deals with its own COVID problems, vaccine exports are stalling and African countries are feeling the pinch.
And a multi-million dollar boost for conservation efforts in the Galapagos Islands. All after the latest news.
BBC News with Neil Newkirk. New York's Attorney General has told the Trump Organization that a civil investigation into the former U.S. president's business dealings is now a criminal probe. The inquiry focuses on whether Mr. Trump's firms falsely inflated property values to obtain loans. He's allegedly denied wrongdoing. Violence between Israel and Palestinian militants in Gaza has continued into a tenth day, with more airstrikes and rocket fire overnight. Two people described by local sources in Gaza as militants were killed. The world's biggest vaccine manufacturer, the Serum Institute of India, says it doesn't expect to resume exports until the end of the year. The firm said although it was boosting production of coronavirus jabs, its priority was to help India. In Institute had been the main supplier to the global vaccine sharing program COVAX. France is easing coronavirus restrictions today with bar and restaurant terraces reopening, along with museums, cinemas and non-essential shops. The finance minister said it was a symbolic step in the country's economic recovery. China has accused the U.S. of threatening peace and stability after an American warship sailed through the Strait of Taiwan. The U.S. Navy said this transit was in accordance with international law. A former senior member of the FARC rebel group Jesus Santrich has been killed in Venezuela. His dissident group says he was ambushed by Colombian troops. Colombia said he died in a gang fight. Mr. Santrich was among those who signed a peace deal with the Colombian government 5 years ago. And a policeman in Ecuador has been sentenced to 3 years in jail for attempting to smuggle over 180 baby tortoises off their home in the Galapagos Islands. More than 30 of the protected creatures died after being wrapped in plastic.
Thank you. Hello. Welcome to Newsday. Claire and James with you. We'll start in Jordan in just a moment. We'll also look at how India's own COVID crisis is leaving African countries such as Kenya with only a fraction of the vaccines they'd hoped for. And we'll hear why Leonardo DiCaprio and others are putting serious money on conservation efforts in the Galapagos Islands. Sports news as ever with Isaac Fannin. That's Newsday over the next 30 minutes.
But as the conflict between Israel and Hamas continues with neither side backing down, protests in support of the Palestinians are also taking place daily across the Middle East. Earlier in the week, we heard from Lebanon. In neighbouring Jordan, protesters have demonstrated right across the country, including at the Israeli border. The Hashemite Kingdom signed its own peace treaty with Israel in 1994, and that agreement recognises Jordan's role as custodian of many of Jerusalem's holy sites for Christians and Muslims, including the Al-Aqsa Mosque, where tensions between Israeli forces and Palestinian worshippers turned violent. Susanna Husus reports now from the Jordanian capital, Amman.
With the escalation of tension and violence in the region over the past week, Jordan has been watching with great concern, as it is home to the biggest Palestinian population outside Israel, with more than 2 million Palestinian refugees living across the country. Over the past week, demonstrations have been held across the country to show solidarity with the Palestinians, including the area surrounding the Israeli embassy in the Jordanian capital, Amman. In Amman, thousands of Jordanians have been protesting in front of the Israeli embassy. Protesters have been holding placards that read "Free Palestine, Save Al-Aqsa Mosque, and the right of return for Palestinian refugees is a sacred right." Protesters are also demanding the protection of holy sites in Jerusalem, the closure of the Israeli embassy in Amman, and cutting ties with Israel in all sectors.
We have several demands at Jordanian society. The first one is to cancel the peace treaty between Jordan and the Zionist entity.
They definitely want them to revoke the gas deal with Israel.
We demand that the world looks at Palestinians as humans and not second-tier citizens like they do now in Israel.
As the political sphere witnesses more tension in the region, attention is being drawn to Amman, not only due to demonstrations, but also due to what is known as the Hashemite custodianship of Jerusalem's Islamic and Christian holy sites. Jordan's monarch, King Abdullah II, has been vocal in his criticism of Israel when there have been previous clashes between Israeli forces and Palestinians around Al-Aqsa Mosque, which is considered the third holiest site in Islam.
What lessons do we teach young people when armed personnel enter Al-Aqsa Mosque, even as Muslim worshippers gather to pray? As a Hashemite custodian, I am bound by a special duty to protect Jerusalem's Islamic and Christian holy sites.
The Hashemites have been the custodians of Al-Aqsa Mosque for almost a century, since 1924 in what was known as Mandatory Palestine. In 1994, the Jordanian and Israeli governments signed a peace treaty which states that Israel must commit to respecting the special role of Jordan in regards to the holy sites in Jerusalem, Atayfal Al-Fayez, the spokesperson of the Jordanian Foreign Ministry.
The custodianship plays a crucial and significant role in preserving the Arabic, Muslim and Christian historical, cultural and religious identity of the holy sites and the legal and historical status quo to prevent any illegal unilateral actions by Israeli authorities. Any attempts to alter the status quo will most definitely stir massive anger and resentment, as we have seen recently. Therefore, the Hashemite custodianship over holy sites plays an important role in maintaining peace and harmony in the holy city of Jerusalem.
The rhetoric here is clear, but how does custodianship actually lead to any influence in mediating between Israel and Palestinians when a conflict occurs, especially when it's related to Jerusalem? Saad Hatter, a political analyst, explains to what extent Jordan has a role.
This is a powerful tool I think Jordan can wield in order to try to push Israel into calming the volatile situation in the West Bank, especially in East Jerusalem. Jordan has good offices with all European countries, Western countries, United States, but other than that, other than the diplomatic channel or the cautioning based on the peace treaty with Israel, Jordan cannot and does not have genuine power on the ground.
And as the ongoing conflict shows no sign yet of de-escalation, some of the regional key players, like Egypt, are working towards achieving a truce between Hamas and Israel, while Jordan stresses on its efforts that aim at safeguarding Islamic and Christian holy sites in Jerusalem, which comes in line with the Hashemite custodianship according to international agreements.
Taking a look at the protests going on in Jordan in support of the Palestinians in Gaza in particular, that's Susanna Goussis reporting from the Jordanian capital, Amman, and we're going to be talking to somebody from the business side of things in Gaza in the next hour of the programme.
Newsday on the BBC World Service. Let's head to Kenya now with the worrying news that the country could run out of COVID-19 vaccines as early as next week. Kenya has only received about 1 million doses from an expected 3 million under the COVAX program. We talked to our correspondent Ferdinand Mondi in Nairobi. Morning, Ferdinand. So what's the problem here? Is it India's decision not to keep exporting vaccines?
That appears to be the biggest problem, because in Kenya and indeed much of Africa, they have been depending on the equitable sharing COVAX program, of which India is the single largest supplier. And yesterday, just more recently, that India already had stopped sending the vaccines to COVAX. And yesterday now, we saw that the Serum Institute of India, which is also the world's largest vaccine supplier, now saying that they are not going to be exporting COVAX to other countries, and they expect to resume by the end of this year. So while Kenya was expecting a new batch in June, actually in May that's going to happen, there's no word in June, and so the earliest Kenya can expect to start delivering new vaccines is in August, hopefully, if the deal with Johnson & Johnson goes through, because there's a direct negotiation, as the government says, with Johnson & Johnson for 30 million single doses.
What happens then in the meantime to those, for example, who've had their first jab and are due a second?
I spoke to Dr. Willis Akwale, who is the chairman of Kenya's COVID-19 Vaccine Deployment Task Force, and he was non-committal. At first, they were expected to receive it early May, and then now it was pushed to June. And initially, the explanation that was given to those who were expecting to receive the second dose was that research has shown that if they extend it by more than 2 weeks, up to 12 weeks, then the defense system by the vaccine gets stronger. But now it is more apparent because there is absolutely no vaccine, and that's why they've already almost run out of the 1 million doses. The ones that are actually remaining are from parts of Kenya where the uptake has been low, so they were thinking of redistribution. A lot of Kenyans have been worried, and they've just been told you just have to wait because there is simply nowhere to get a vaccine at the moment, certainly not AstraZeneca.
What's public mood on this like? Are people frustrated perhaps that the government didn't order things earlier? Are they blaming For example, Western countries, which have been able to vaccinate so many of their citizens, but haven't perhaps shared those vaccines around the world. What are people saying?
The biggest frustration for Kenya is that the government appears to be focusing a lot on the botched constitution review process as opposed to actively seeking the vaccine. I think many Kenyans feel like getting the vaccine and fighting COVID-19 is a priority. And when the government is doing that, the goodwill from the state and much of the efforts in the face of Kenyans has been trying to change the constitution by August next year. The High Court already dismissed the process, which in Kenya is known as the Building Bridges Initiative or the BBI. Mm-hmm. But recently, we saw even the health minister coming forward and say that in as much as the court has stopped it, they're going to appeal and they will deliver the constitution by August next year. And already more than $10 million, I think, has been spent on that process itself. And people are now seeing that this misplaced priority, it has quite literally divided the country down the middle, and now people are looking at it in terms of the 2022 elections. The government has defended itself, saying, yes, we are trying to do the best we can, but suddenly the energy felt in this country is that of disappointment, because the focus seems not so much on how to get Kenyans out of this quagmire, but rather how to deliver a political process, which many think is a bit selfish.
Fernando Mundi reporting live from